Good afternoon. Welcome at this fourth seminar of IADC. After three seminars about the, let's say, the peripheral matters around dredging, this ecology, hydraulic fill, for instance, not unimportant, but now here also because of the 50th anniversary of IADC, I would like to focus on the hardcore of dredging, let's say, equipment. This is not a lecture into depth. It is just a brief introduction. So it's for people to familiarize them with dredging. It is a bit about the why, it's a bit about what, and it's a bit about how. If you want to go more into depth, there are seminars, the IADC dredging seminars being held in Delft and in Singapore or Jakarta this year. And another course is the joint effort of IADC and CEDA, that is the Central Dredging Organization, about the environmental aspects of dredging. About myself, I've been working in dredging for 37 years. I have a degree in coastal engineering at the Delft University, and I had several technical positions in dredging. So let's start off with listing some projects so that you get a bit of feel about the size of projects, I mean the bigger ones, about the drivers of projects, and also to put things in a historical perspective. All right, then we start off with Dubai in the 70s. This is Jebel Ali Port. There was nothing before. It was just desert, and a port was dug into the coast. 120 million cubic meters of rock dredging, quite substantial for that time. And here the contractor adapted to this by building four new cutter suction dredger, because it was known that the Gulf area would pose quite some technical problems to the existing dredgers. So newly built dredgers were in fact required. Those dredgers, called jumbo dredgers at that time, but nowadays they are quite small actually, 1500 kilowatt on the cutter only. And that is, but on the other hand, it's still the biggest rock project carried out by one single contractor. The next one is the history of Hong Kong. In Hong Kong over the years, 9 container terminals were constructed. A number of residential areas, port areas, and Disneyland, huge reclamation works, and that all culminated in the very last one, and that was the Hong Kong International Airport. 240 million cubic meters of material. So quite substantial. Another thing to realize here, that at most projects, the topsoil, the soft topsoil, was removed first before sand was pumped in. Before I move on to the next slide about Singapore, I would put a question to you, and that is this one. Between 1965 and 2013, Singapore grew tremendously. It started off in 1965 with 580 square kilometers. And what do you think is the size now? I mean, in 2013. Okay. Then I stop the poll and I will show you the results here. What you see is actually it is 704 square meters. Most answers were 800 square kilometers, but that is the plan for 2030. In 2013 is 704 square kilometers. Nevertheless, substantial, about 22% increase nowadays already. And what you see on the map is the pink ones have been completed now, here, Changi Airport, Jurong Islands and Tuas, and the darker ones are going to be constructed in the coming years. These projects here, and also the Changi one, were reclamation projects with volumes of sand up to 900 million cubic meters. So quite substantial, quite big. Yeah. And here in the southwest is all industrial. This is an airport and all the other, and this is also industrial, but all the other areas are residential. We move on to Dubai from, let's say, 2000 onwards. I showed you Jebel Ali, that is the port area, but then from 2000 onwards, the possibilities for leisure and tourism and for residents was the aim of a lot more reclamation work. So what you see is a coastline extension, a planned coastline extension from 72 to 192 kilometers. And you see here, this is the Jebel Ali Palm, and this is the Palm Jumeirah, and this is the world. These three have been completed, but the waterfront here was suspended due to the crisis, and this one is still going on, but at a lower speed. So, huge projects. Then we move on to Qatar. In 2005, the big LNG port was started to be constructed. The LNG was pumped to the shore here and being exported through this port. That is the plan. These breakwaters have a length of about 10 kilometers. Yeah, and so it's quite substantial. There was some reclamation, there was rock dredging, and there was a substantial amount of rock work. I mean, constructing breakwaters and constructing revetments. And the total value of the project was $2 billion. Not surprisingly, it was a joint venture work, but a lot of money was involved in the construction of the breakwaters and revetments. During this lecture, during this webinar, I would like to focus on dredging and not about all the other matters, because in dredging we also have offshore work for platforms at sea, placing windmills and all that sort of things. That's not what we are going to discuss here. This is just about dredging and the equipment in particular. Then the next one is the Port of Rotterdam, the Europort extension. That was a reclamation work, 230 million cubic meters. The weekly production at the top was 3.5 million cubic meters per week. Also here, quite substantial breakwater and revetment works. Also a big project. So before I move on to the next slide about the Suez Canal, and then this is how many cubic meters are dredged per day at the Suez Canal. It is 250,000, 500,000, 1 million or 1.5 million cubic meters per day. What do you think? Okay, I stopped the poll. It is a break even, more or less, between the first three, but the actual answer is on the next slide, and that is more than 1 million cubic meters per day. Also here, big joint ventures are carrying out the works to do this within 1 year. The canal will be opened this August, and the dredging works were started last autumn. So quite substantial. Then putting things into perspective. I showed you quite big projects, quite big infrastructure works. And so you may think, well, that must be a big industry. Well, the total turnover of all dredging contractors together during 2013 was 11.7 billion euro. And then on top of that, I must say that 45% of that turnover is close to public tendering. So the market share, or the open market share, is 55%. 47% is shared by the IADC members and 8% by others. So what you see here is a relatively small industry, knowing that the Fortune top 500, the bottom of the top 500 starts at, I think, 15 or 20 billion US dollars. And here we talk at the total turnover of all dredging contractors together, about 11.5 billion. So it's a relatively small industry, globally speaking, but with a high infrastructural impact. So now the core. I must say, we're going to talk about equipment, what happened in history with companies, and what were the developments over the years. So first of all, what is dredging actually? So if I talk about that, then the definition is actually is quite simple. The dredging is taking soil from an underwater location to another location, and that location may be on land or underwater. But the key word here is that the source is an underwater location. Nowadays, we have three prime movers. The cutter suction dredger, the trailing suction hopper dredger, and the backhoe dredger doing the works. That doesn't mean that there are no other pieces of equipment, but they are not as important as these three. And also due to the fact that we only have half an hour or so to talk about these matters, I limit myself to these three. So just to give you an impression, we talk about cutter suction dredgers. This is although we see four pictures of the same size, and so they seem to have the same size, but the lower left dredger is much, much bigger than the upper right one. The upper right one is a small one, and the lower left one is a big one. Another thing you can see here is that the usual discharging method is by pipeline, but also barges may be used to discharge material. Talking about parts, the most important one thing to realize is that we have a pontoon here with a ladder, and at the end of the ladder there's a cutter head, and that rotates, and that is dislodging the soil, and the entire pontoon swings around this spud. And here in this top view here, you can see that a bit better. Then the cutter moves along this circle, and while the soil is being dislodged, it's being sucked up by pumps here and here, and then discharged through this pipeline. So before I move on to the next, and here this is a detail of a cutter. You see blades and there's all kind of pick points on the edges of the blades cutting the soil. Before I move on to the next slide, then I've got a question. Which statement is incorrect with regard to cutter suction dredgers? Incorrect. The question is, which statement is incorrect? Uh, I stop. I stop the poll. And 50% of the answers is about it cuts only rocks. And then another 20% is about vulnerable to waves. And another one is about stationary dredger. And the fourth one is a little bit, it discharges via pipeline. If I go to the answers, and that's on the next slide, then what you see, indeed, it is a stationary dredger. So because of this, it may be a hindrance to shipping. If a vessel has to pass by, then the cutter suction dredger has to move out of the way. And that is quite a job. As it is connected to the bottom by its putt and cutter, it's vulnerable to waves, and especially to swell, the longer waves. The entire pontoon will go up and down, and the cutter will bounce on the bottom when it goes down again. It may cut all kinds of soils. It is a multi-purpose vessel. And what you have seen on one of the pictures before, it also discharges into barges, so not only via pipeline. There are many more aspects to tell, but all details goes too far for this webinar. Talking about productions, what can you expect? And this is just to emphasize that it is very important to know the circumstances under which that piece of equipment is working, and to know what sort of material is being cut and what is the size of the dredger. So this is indicative, but just to show you the range, what can you expect? And that doesn't mean that if we are dredging clay or silt, that is, it is always 900,000 cubic meter per week. It may be more, it may be less, but it is the indication. So that is huge, from 900,000 down to below 100,000 cubic meters per week. We move on to the other prime mover, and that is the trailing suction hopper dredger. Also, again here, pictures of the same size, and the one at in the lower left corner, that is a mid-size one, 4,000 cubic meters hopper content, and at the lower right size, that is a very big one, with a hopper content of 35,000 cubic meters. On these pictures, you don't see much difference between. Only on the upper right, you see there's a big difference between those two, but that is a very small one, the front one. Here, the same issue, you see a lot of difference between the one at the front and the one in the middle. And if we go to the parts, then I can explain you a bit more about what is important here. Actually, the most important one is that there is a suction pipe, that is this thing here. And at the end of the suction pipe, there's a drag head which is being trailed over the bottom, dislodging the soil, almost always helped by jet water pointing into the bottom. The material which is sucked up is being discharged into the hopper, that is this one here. The material settles, and the excess transport water flows over into the sea again. Another one important thing to know is here is the word swell compensator. That is a device that enables the drag head to stay on the bottom, although the bottom is undulating or the vessel is going up and down. So that extends the workability of this vessel tremendously. When the hopper is filled, the suction pipe is hoisted on board again, and the vessel sails to the discharge area. And after having arrived then, there are a number of possibilities to unload. First of all, bottom door disposal, just opening the bottom doors, and the material just falls out. Another one is rainbowing, so the hopper is pumped out by its own pumps, discharging material directly on land. And the last one is pumping out the hopper through a pipeline so that the material can be discharged a bit further inland. And especially these latter two are important, or are still very important for reclamation works. So before I move on to the next question, then I've got a question about these trailing suction hopper dredgers. Which statement is incorrect? What do you think? It's self-propelled, or it's sensitive to waves, it can dredge up to 150 meters dredging depths, or it is capable for or suited for long distance transport. What do you think? Okay, I top the poll. And about 50% of you have answered or have given the correct answer, and that is, it is sensitive to waves. Because it's self-propelled, it's a sea-going vessel, so it's rather independent. It can go anywhere, provided there's sufficient depth, water depth. The discharge, maybe through bottom doors or pipeline, it would hardly obstruct traffic, and it's not very sensitive to waves because due to that swell compensator I showed you, it is capable of working in 3.5 meters of waves. Indeed, with special meshes, the bigger trailer suction hopper dredgers can reach 150 meter water depths, and the bigger ones are also suited for long distance transport. I mean, tenths or maybe 100 kilometers or so. Important to note, of course, is that we talk about sand, silt and clay mostly, instead of what we saw at the cutter suction dredger. And it is nowadays the bigger ones are also capable of dredging soft rock, but that is very soft rock. Then we talk about the production range. Also here, that range is huge, and also here indicative. And this is why dredging contractors have departments with people specialized in translating all the circumstances like soil characteristics and waves, etc., into production. How much is that dredger doing under those circumstances per week? Also here, from 1.5 million cubic meters per week down to, let's say, a couple of hundred thousands. And the horizontal scale is about goes from easy to difficult, because there are many different situations which may influence the production level. For instance, if you look at the soil, if you have fine sand and it is densely packed, it's very difficult to dredge, but it also settles the settling rate in the hopper is poor, so a lot of material will flow over again. So that is a difficult situation, and the same is when there's a lot of if it's difficult to let's say to turn, if it's a narrow water, etc. So depending on circumstances. Then the third prime mover is the backhoe dredger, and here you see two. There are many smaller ones. This is a bit a mid-size range. Here, the top left is between 4.5 and 11 cubic meter bucket size, and the lower right goes up to 24 cubic meter bucket size. Well, nowadays, maximum bucket sizes of 40 cubic meters are on the market as well. And 40 cubic meters, please realize that we talk about a room of 4 by 4 meters and with a height of 2.5 meters, and that in one scoop. So that is quite substantial. And the dredging depth of these dredgers is about 15 to 30 meters, but the deeper, the higher depths are only with smaller buckets. The parts important here is that we have two spuds here, which are put on the bottom and keep the position, keep the pontoon in position. So there are no wires or anchors or whatever. And here the excavator is working. So still connected to the bottom, but a bit easier to move than cutter suction dredges because there are no wires. The work method, what you see here is that here is the excavator seeing from the top, working along this circle. So it takes a scoop here, discharges it into the barge, and then moving back to this position, and then take a scoop from the adjacent position here, etc. And when this circle has been completed, then the entire pontoon moves backward into this direction. That is how it works, in a few words. So indeed, it is a stationary dredger, and it may be a hindrance to shipping, although a bit less than the cutter suction dredger. It is, of course, it is vulnerable to waves, but because it's a mechanical dredger and just scraping over the bottom, it is able to dredge quite accurately. It's discharging into barges, and again, also here, the softer types of soil, sand, silt, clay, soft rock. But important to note here is that boulders and debris can be dredged as well, without many problems. Trailer suction hopper dredgers working in debris is just a big drama. They are hampered very much, and you will find that stuff in all ports. Also here, an indicative production, weekly output, and I'm just talking about smaller dredges and bigger dredges. And that ranges from, let's say, a couple of thousand cubic meters per week up to 150,000 cubic meters per week. Okay, one statement about history. And not surprisingly, I will focus on the Netherlands mainly, and a bit Belgium. But if you look at the earliest, the early years of the 20th century, there were many small companies. And there were a number of substantial projects, big projects, like the Afsluitdijk, the closure dam in the north, the polders, the closures after the war, the flooding in 1953, etc. All kind of big projects. And after those projects, it was a graveyard of contractors, because there was no work anymore. From the 1950s onwards, we can see a lot of mergers. So they joined forces, and at the end, nowadays, we talk about two big Dutch companies and two big Belgium companies. So I'm not talking about Asia or other parts of the world. This is just about the Netherlands and Belgium. And what you see there in the lower left is, I think it's the closure dam in the north or one of the other works, but a lot of cranes. And here at the lower right, you see land is being reclaimed by trailing suction hopper dredgers. So what are or what were the developments? That is important to know. Just have a look. I spoke about Jebel Ali, 1978. You see a number of these, what were called jumbo dredgers those days, together. And if I compare this picture with this one, which was taken this year in the Suez Canal, you see more or less the same, a number of dredgers, They don't look very different from this distance. So what is the difference? Also, if you look at the trailers here, a trailer in Londonderry in Northern Ireland, 1981. And if I compare this one to Fremantle a couple of years ago, what is the difference? From the outside, it doesn't look very different. So there must have happened a lot under the hood. So what I would like to focus on is about the size of the equipment, and then the parts of the equipment, the precision and the guidance, survey. That has been developed over the years quite tremendously. I compare it to the 70s, if you talk about cutter suction dredges, and then the maximum size at those days had a cutter power of 3,000 kilowatt. And nowadays there is one planned for 2017, and that is 8,500 kilowatt. So it's almost three times as big, 2.5 to 3 times. And also the total installed power on board, so including pumps and winches and all that sort of things, is about three times bigger than before. So, and especially since the 90s, we saw a tremendous increase in size of these cutter suction dredges. Trailer suction hopper dredges, the same issue, but here we focus on the hopper content. 1978, late 70s, the maximum hopper content or size was about 10,000 cubic meters. And nowadays we talk about 46,000 cubic meters. That's the number between brackets. There are a few of those. There are more dredges or 35,000 cubic meters hopper content. Total power, same story, 12,000 kilowatt in 1978, and now it's three times or 3.5 times as much. So also here, the increase in size started in the 90s. And I think that the cause of that is that we had a crisis in the 80s. And after that, there were some mergers again. There was some reluctance for new investments, and after that, when the companies became bigger, there was a the investments came one after the other. So what are the other improvements? Because you may upscale all the equipment for higher productions and that sort of things, but all the parts need to be improved as well. So what you see is here wear resistant materials, of course, the cutters and the tees. And the if we talk about cutters and tees in the 70s, 80s, 90s, let's say the strength of concrete was quite common as the maximum type of material that could be dredged in terms of strength. Nowadays we have doubled that figure. So we can dredge material twice as strong as concrete, without reinforcement, of course. Pumps and impellers also better shapes and better materials. Stronger spuds, especially hydraulic systems. If you look at the backhoe dredges I mentioned, they could not exist to that level they have now without these very well developed hydraulic systems. And then of course the jet systems on the trailing suction hopper dredges, together with well developed drag heads, jet systems are vital for the release of material. Okay, and then If you look at the engines, we have the variable frequency drives, so they can be controlled quite accurately. The speed of the drives can be controlled quite accurately with variable by varying the frequencies. And we talk about normal electrical engines and not the big direct current ones from the past. I received a couple of questions. So the question is, can soft rock also be rainbowed? And the answer is no, because it's quite difficult to transport the material inside the hopper towards the suction line in the bottom of the hopper. So it can be released by bottom doors, but if the size is too big, it can't be rainbowed anymore. So up to a certain size, but not much. And the other question is, which kind of equipment will have more work in future, hoppers or cutters? Well, that is a market question. I'm a technical person, but on the other hand, I would say I think hoppers will still have most work in future. I think history confirms that. Hoppers is a more constant market than cutter suction dredges. Then another question is, how do you evaluate the wave sensitivity for the different discharge techniques, rainbowing, pumping, etc.? As long as we use trailer suction hopper dredgers, it is not a big issue. The trailers have to keep position while pumping ashore. So if there are waves, it may need to use anchors, but under normal circumstances, it can use its own drives, its own propellers to keep position. Good. Another one for the cutters, and then I will move on. Will cutters get bigger and more powerful? Well, the trend is still yes. Yeah, the one I showed you was planned for 2017, and that is an even bigger one than the biggest one at the moment. At the moment, we talk at the maximum of 7,000 or 7,500 kilowatt installed on the cutter. But the new one will have a cutter power of 4,500 kilowatts, so quite big. I was talking about the jet systems here on this slide, together with drag heads, and nowadays jet water is supplied at a rate of more than 50% of the suction pump capacity. Another important matter to remember is that precision plays a role as well. You may enlarge the scale of these hoppers, dredgers. But on the other hand, if the production goes up, then you have to keep control that you're not going too deep and too far. And so precision becomes more and more important. And thanks to the electronics, I mean, electrical circuits, but also software and also the use of displays, they help the operators to do their job and also to automate part of the process. It's very important, and this is just a parallel development together with all the equipment I showed you. Other important thing is that you know where you are. Yeah? The positioning systems based on satellite navigation, they provide a precision or a centimeter precision of the aerial installed on board. Yeah? So the actual cutter or a drag head can be calculated to, let's say, 20 centimeters accuracy, 10, 20 centimeters. Another important thing is that the process can be logged, and that is for those departments I mentioned about calculating these productions. That's a vital thing to support their knowledge and to improve their knowledge. Then I was talking about satellite navigation. In the past, we had this sort of systems, quite expensive, not very accurate. And now all they have been replaced by this satellite navigation. Also here I talk about RTK DGPS, but DGPS is already quite accurate, but using these RTK, the real-time kinematics, then also the vertical dimension can be measured by satellite navigation to that accuracy. I have a number of other questions, but first finish my last few slides, and then I will come back on those questions. The other one is measuring the depth of the water depths with echo sounders. And in the past, there were single beam echo sounders. Processing the data was a manual process, quite cumbersome, time consuming. And nowadays, since the 1998, there are multi-beam echo sounders. Just mapping the seafloor in big chunks. So what you see at the left here is the old-fashioned systems they used when I started in the 70s, and this is a picture of what a multi-beam system can provide. It is expensive, but it may provide us you. And another big thing is that as we are using computer software to process all the data, the updating of the dredge bottom can be very, very quickly. And so that means you can measure or survey in the morning, and later that day, the latest results can be installed on the dredger, so that they know where to dredge and where not to dredge. So that brings us to the conclusion, and that is that the bigger equipment was developed to cope with big projects or to cope with short execution times. Remember the Suez Canal, within I think 10 months or so that latest one was completed. Then just by developing this bigger equipment, parts had to be improved. And then another important matter is that you need a higher precision to avoid dredging too deep or too wide, because these higher productions, if you are not guiding this properly, then you don't know what you've done. And sometimes the soil can be dredged quite easily, and you are dredging, let's say, 1 or 2 meters in one trail, and that is a lot. Software nowadays enables a high level of process control. That is also quite important to understand. In the beginning, when I started, that was not on the market. It was all, there was some electronic matters, but good process control was not on board. And of course, the better and faster survey techniques to keep the productions or to keep yourself under control, that you're not dredging too much. So knowing that bigger equipment, everything is bigger, you have to do a lot of investigations, a lot of improvements. That means that the company mergers, they have enabled these higher investments, and the adequate developments have become possible because of these mergers. All right. So what you see is that markets change and contractors adapt to it. And also they predict the future, and then they develop new equipment to adapt to that future. Right. So this is the end almost of my story. If you want to know more detail, then at that website, iadc-dredging.com, you can find a lot of fact sheets which explain into detail what this sort of equipment can do and how it works. Another thing, I mentioned the seminars, of course. also can also be found on that website. Then another one is that, yeah, the questions. I will do the questions now. Yeah, okay. Have a look. Is there an ideal sweep size length for maximum efficiency for a cutter suction dredger? Well, if you mean what sort of width can be dredged, that strongly depends on the size of the dredger. Yeah, with a long dredger, you can dredge wider or narrower or whatever. So it all depends on that size of dredger. And another thing to remember is if it's very shallow water, you have to be aware of the of the fact that you have limits at the sides. All this is explained in those fact sheets. Then, what is the maximum strength that a cutter suction dredger can remove in situ without pretreatment? Yes, well, that is the one I mentioned in the past, up to the, let's say, a couple of years ago. We said, well, that is concrete, let's say 35 megapascal, that's about what can be dredged. Nowadays, we with special measures, special cutter heads, and with a high level of control, we dredge double of that. Is there any mechanism for separation of good material and bad material to be used in reclamation or on board? Well, in reclamation, fines may be kept in suspension, so you can arrange your discharge area in such a way that the fine material may travel quite far and the coarser material may settle directly. So that is difficult, but if you then I would like to refer to the hydraulic fill manual, which goes into a lot of detail about these measures as well. On board, there is not a good separation system on board. It is just a matter of that it flows into the hopper. And the only thing you can do is playing with the pump capacity, and with a lower capacity, the velocities are lower, and more fine material will stay in the hopper than with only coarse material. Then, which type of visualization / control system is shown on this slide? Brand and type. Well, that is in fact a question you should put to the different companies, because there are companies who are developing their in-house systems, yeah, and that is what I showed you, but also some construction companies like IHC, they deliver those systems as well. So there is some marketing, so I can't give you a single answer. Then all right. So these were all the questions. Then I move on to the last one. So if you click here, then you can get a free description to IDC's quarterly journal, and that is the Terran Aqua. Very interesting topics, and it not only talks about dredging equipment, what I've done now, but also about the peripheral matters like ecology and hydraulic fills, etc. Then another important matter to mention is that after having closed the webinar, then you will be able to fill in an evaluation form about this webinar. We would be very obliged if you would do that. Then we know how you found this webinar. So I would like to thank you for all these questions you put to us. That gives well, at least it gives us an idea that people were very interested. So if there are more questions, then IADC is still there, and you can put questions to IADC. I thank you very much for your attention, and well, maybe see you back on the next webinar. Thank you.